Saga Egmont presents The Silent Child by MJ White, read by Lucy Scott. For Al Smith, thank you for the many, many chats that helped bring Cora to the page and for believing in her from the beginning. In some causes, silence is dangerous. St. Ambrose, 339 AD to 397 AD. The realm of silence is large enough beyond the grave. George Eliot, 1819 to 1880. Lottie. I'm not dumb, whatever they say. I'm not. I just choose not to speak. They want me to talk, to prove I'm not dumb. They don't realise what they're asking. What could happen if I talk again? Nobody understands. Nobody knows the truth. But I do. If I could smuggle you inside my head, you'd know I wasn't dumb. You'd hear my thoughts screaming. Because behind the silence, everyone sees I am screaming. I've been screaming for 11 months. It isn't a fad or something I'll grow out of. This is my life now. If you were inside my head, you'd know why I don't speak. Why I can't speak again. Chapter 1. Minshull. The body was badly concealed amid piles of old clothing in the former hay barn, one pale arm clearly visible, hanging between the grubby jumpers and jeans too ripped for anyone to wear. Tossed into a corner, forgotten. There was no dignity in death here. There never was for bodies like these. What a lonely place to die. The farm where they stood lay 12 miles northwest of Ipswich, set back from the narrow country lane that twisted around low-hedged patchwork fields. It was far enough from other farms and buildings to appear remote, yet only a mile away from the nearest village. The twists of the road and the broad fields surrounding it gave it the feeling of being completely cut off from the world. Abbott's farm was abandoned now, not yet grabbed by developers greedy to sell the dream of rural living to wealthy ex-Londoners. The farmhouse was far from derelict, its roof still good, but its darkened windows were cracked and flaky framed, the first beginnings of grasses appearing at the edges where nature had begun to reclaim it. The old barn beside the farmhouse reeked of neglect, mildew and death mingled with ancient straw. It hung in the air like the dust, a thick cloud that clogged your lungs and clung to your clothes. D.S. Rob Minshull gritted his teeth and pressed forward, the ghostly pale face of D.C. Dave Wheeler a pace behind him.
I wouldn't bring my gran to this jumble sale,
Wheeler joked.
I don't blame you,
Minshull smirked. At times like these, humour was the only weapon against creeping dread. He was glad Dave Wheeler was here. Minshull crouched by the body, following the line of the arm from dirt-blackened fingernails up along its deeply scratched bare forearm and over the contour of the clothing pile, trying to make out the rest of its position.
What do you reckon, Sarge? Drugs? Could be.
Who called it in?
Dog walker.
Wheeler grinned when Minshull looked up at him.
Improbable as it sounds.
Out here?
Farmer from the next farm along, walking his dog the long way. His dog suddenly dashed off, and when he managed to catch up with it, it was here, licking the deceased's arm. The farmer has called us before, apparently. 3 months ago. Lights and vehicles and noise here late at night. He thought it was a rave. Shit rave.
Wheeler's chuckle was a tiny gift of warmth to hold on to. There was precious little else to warm the soul here. Scattered around the floor, amid the straw and ancient animal dung, was the telltale paraphernalia of drugs. Spent needles, burned foil and discarded dirty swabs. Lately, more sights like these had come to light, a spiralling problem of the drug trade in desolate rural areas. South Suffolk police were about to launch a widespread investigation following a damning expose in the national press.
Once again, they were on the back foot, battling accusations of bumbling rural police being trampled over by intelligent drug gangs crossing the county border from Essex and London beyond. The body could be yet another victim, another statistic. But something about its position bothered Minshull. It was half hidden under the piles of clothing, but it couldn't have perished there. It had been dumped deliberately and hastily covered with garments in an attempt to conceal it. A stark statement of the person's worthlessness and someone's hurry to be rid of the problem.
So, did the dog smell blood?
Minshull asked, looking around.
There's none around that I can see, and our friend here would have been long dead by the time our doggy chum found him. The farmer thinks it might have been the smell.
That would make sense, Minshull nodded, mentally blocking the scent of death that you never got used to in this job, no matter how many times you encountered it. The edge of a coloured shape where the arm disappeared into the clothing mountain caught his eye. Minshull peered closer, tilting his head.
What do you reckon this is, Dave?
The DC leaned in.
Tattoo of some sort? That's what I thought. I don't want to move the fabric covering it till Socko's get here. Can you work out what it is?
Can't see from here. Hang on. If I grab hold of your shoulder, I reckon I can lean in closer than you can. Shall I give it a go?
Be my guest, Minshull replied, dropping one knee to the dirt floor and keeping his shoulder steady as Wheeler braced against it and leaned towards the body.
Steady. Hold it there, Minch.
Anything?
Just trying to get a bit closer. Oh, it's a top hat.
Minshull frowned.
A what?
A brown, shiny top hat, like magicians pull bunnies out of.
Really? Weird.
He waited as Wheeler pushed back upright, then rose to his feet, brushing a dank brown stain from the knee of his suit trousers.
This could be a magic trick gone horribly wrong,
Wheeler suggested.
Maybe our pal was trying to do a Houdini water tank trick with bags of clothes instead.
Best of luck selling that theory to Anderson,
Minshull grinned. How long before the Soccos arrive?
About 40 minutes, they reckon. They got delayed by that job across the border.
How come Norfolk are nicking our bods?
Wheeler shrugged.
Budgets, Sarge. It's always budgets.
Right. You okay to wait for them? I need to get back to Anderson.
Sure. I don't envy you the task.
Wheeler's grimace said it all.
Me neither, Dave.
Minshull slapped a hand on Dave Wheeler's shoulder as he passed.
Make sure you mention that tattoo to them as soon as they get here. And call me when they've moved our friend, yeah?
The blast of fresh air met his lungs like an elixir as Minshull stalked away from the barn towards the pool car. If the deceased was a victim of a drugs gang, it could be a significant lead in their fledgling investigation into organised drug activity crossing over into Suffolk. D.I. Joel Anderson would be grimly delighted when Minshull briefed him of the details. Not about the death, but about the step forward it might offer them. But the body bothered Minshull. It didn't feel like a simple death. Anderson, wishing for a clear-cut lead, would not be delighted to hear that. Chapter 2. Cora. Case LLM462/LMA, briefing. Subject, Lottie May Arundel. Age, 15 years, 2 months. Address, Four Winds, Upper Branscroft Road, Woodcham, St. Mary. Issue, has not spoken for 11 months. Notes. Initial interviews conducted with family, friends and teachers have largely drawn a blank. While Lottie is willing to communicate via written notes and her adapted iPad, she refuses to be drawn on her reasons for not speaking. Lottie has received 2 courses of speech therapy and has been under the care of a consultant neurologist. Neither the speech therapists nor consultant have been able to identify any physiological or neurological reason for her lack of speech. Current conclusion is that she is displaying indicators of elective mutism.
Family interviews have so far revealed no reason for trauma or significant events that could have triggered the condition. School interviews suggested the same. Close friends will only confirm that she ceased speaking 11 months ago. They offer no reason why. Dr. Cora Lyell frowned at the case file and wondered what on earth she could find in common with an electively mute 15-year-old. Her new boss was watching her like a hopeful puppy. In her 3 months of working with him in the South Suffolk Education Authority's Educational Psychology Unit, Cora had already learned the danger of this expression. It was endearing, but it ultimately signalled more work for her. Why do you think I can find a different outcome? Dr. Tristram Noakes shrugged and pushed a tin of biscuits across his desk towards her. Another warning sign. Not everyone in the department got offered biscuits. Honestly, I'm not sure you can, but we've reached an impasse and the kids' parents are threatening legal action. So much for my show-stopping expertise, then. It isn't like that. Cora raised an eyebrow. Seriously, Cora, it isn't. You see things others miss. I think we need that year. Standard approaches just haven't worked, and the longer we go on relentlessly pursuing the same old things, the more we'll hit brick walls. And litigation. Tris gave a sigh as heavy as the invisible weight on his shoulders. That, too. We're underfunded as it is. Expensive legal bills could close us down. I don't know, Tris. Just meet her at least. Get a sense of where she's at. He dipped his head a little. See what you can hear? Cora smiled. His carefulness was sweet. Telling people about her emotional synesthesia, the ability to sense emotional echoes from discarded objects, still felt like a risk. But since she'd returned to Suffolk from the wilds of Devon's South Hams, it was part of her new life. The study she'd helped research and write with the University of South Suffolk was published, and now her condition was known, if not yet widely. As it turned out, Tris Noakes had met her in the pages of the study before she'd joined the team as consultant psychologist. When Cora had mentioned during her interview for the job that she was the quoted subject A in the study, she'd been surprised by Triss's reaction. It was the first time anyone had met the news of her condition with unbridled admiration. Triss was a safe place when it came to Cora's ability, and that calmed the rush of nerves that always followed any mention of it. When are you next seeing her? Triss offered a sheepish smile. I'm due over there at 11 today. Cora stared at him. Triss? I know. Talk about putting me on the spot. You wouldn't have to come today if you didn't feel ready, but it could be a good opportunity to meet her. She should have seen it coming. But Tris Noakes was offering her his most pleading smile, and it was hard to resist. So tell me what you know already. She seems like a good kid, apart from the silence. Not overly timid, carries herself well, is reportedly bright and a good student. I think that's why it doesn't make sense. If she found social situations awkward or suffered from anxiety or low self-esteem, her lack of speech would be more logical. How does she communicate? She has an iPad with a text-to-speech function. It's strange. After a while, you forget she isn't physically speaking the words. And she's given no indication of what stopped her speaking. No. He risked a smile. Admit it. You're intrigued. There has to be something else going on there. She smiled at her own admission. Okay, yes, it could be interesting. A bit of warning would have been preferable, of course. Best to strike while the iron's hot. Tris grinned. Or before you think better of it. I think you might be the difference, Cora. Give us a different perspective, not a typical medical professional approach that investigates, labels and leaves. I don't know. Maybe Lottie might respond to that. Cora leaned back, feeling the chair back sturdy and strong against her spine. The shoulder injury she'd sustained from 2 gunshots over a year ago could make sitting for long periods of time uncomfortable. Tris Noakes's high-backed office chair provided welcome relief. I can't promise I'll get her to speak, but I'll meet her with you today. See how we get on. Tris clapped his hands and helped himself to a celebratory biscuit. That's all I'm asking.
Who knows? Maybe you and Lottie will hit it off. Why would a 15-year-old refuse to speak? Cora had to admit it was a puzzle that appealed to her. Back at her desk, with the case notes open, she picked up a photograph. A dark-haired, hazel-eyed girl stared out, surrounded by laughing friends at what looked like a party, her face strangely unmoved as her eyes bore into the camera. A chill passed through her as Cora recalled photographs of herself in her late teens. Pages upon pages in her mother's photograph album, the backdrops shifting through family celebrations, holidays, and college graduation, but her wild, staring expression unchanged in all of them. The unmistakable mark of someone who felt they were an outsider. What had stolen Lottie Arundel's words? Or who? Chapter 3. Anderson. It was a PR nightmare. Another one. DCI Sue Taylor was doing her nut, sweeping around the corridors of South Suffolk Constabulary HQ like a raging, screeching northern banshee. Maybe if she'd listened to DI Joel Anderson 6 months ago, they wouldn't be on the back foot with this now. But Sue Taylor chose not to, because Sue Taylor would never admit Anderson was right. An internal investigation following the high-profile missing child case in St. Just a year ago had ruled that Anderson and his CID team had been justified in their recruitment of a civilian consultant. His superior officer, anticipating the book being thrown at him, had been shocked by the verdict, and now was hell-bent on wreaking her revenge on Anderson in any way she could. Had he been closer to the correct age for early retirement, she would have pensioned him off immediately. But until that was an option, she had resorted to thwarting him at every turn. Anderson understood personal vendettas as much as anyone in the force. He'd seen them in action too many times during his career. But DCI Taylor's obsession with dismissing him had bit her in the behind this time. 6 months ago, he'd raised the issue of drug gangs heading to the wilds of rural Suffolk to bring their unwanted trade into the county. He'd seen increasing reports from the public of suspected drug houses and wanted the force to nip the issue in the bud before it spiraled out of control. But DCI Taylor had dismissed it out of turn. "That might be a problem for the city forces, Joel, but we're small fry. There's not enough potential trade in Suffolk to warrant any major gang's attention. I'm not committing valuable time and resources to a minor problem. We've far more pressing issues to attend to." She was eating those words now, wasn't she? The special report in The Sentinel, published a week ago and now flooding every news outlet, claimed that dangerous drug gangs, keen to avoid the increased scrutiny of the police in London and Essex, were heading into Suffolk to trade under the radar. The last place anyone expects to be a haven for the drug trade is sleepy, picturesque Suffolk, the report stated. But now the county most likely to appeal to OAP coach tours and holidaying families is the destination du jour for organised drug crime. And all of it is happening without any concerted effort from South Suffolk Police. Local residents have seen warning signs for years, but it appears the county's law enforcers have turned a blind eye. With Suffolk now reliant on the tourist trade for survival, could this willful negligence by police threaten the very lifeblood of this county? It was the first piece of adverse publicity the force had encountered for a year, arriving just at the moment when Anderson was congratulating himself on a pretty decent run of avoiding the headlines. Compared with other constabularies in the country, that was an achievement indeed. He still didn't like to think of the last time South Suffolk CID had faced the wrath of the media, even though in the end they had emerged, phoenix-like, from the ashes of slander. He'd recommenced counselling at his wife's insistence, and while he grumbled every week about going, privately he valued each session. Lately, he'd felt a return to his old self, a recalibration of his sharp mind that had served him so faithfully before. Smugness wasn't a part of the therapy, but today it was a reward.
Rural drug dealers aren't a priority, Joel. Our budgets only stretch so far.
They'll be a priority now, though, won't they, Sue?
Anderson relaxed back in his chair, enjoying the warm rays of sunlight sneaking in between the slats of his office window blinds. Today was going to be a good day.
Gov?
DC Kate Bennett knocked against the wooden architrave of Anderson's open office doorway.
Ah, Kate, lovely day, don't you think?
Bennett hovered uncertainly by the open door.
Sure, Gov.
He smiled broad and wide, resisting the urge to laugh at his earnest colleague. Bennett was a great DC. By rights, she should have been DS now instead of Rob Minshull. But Anderson worried a little for her. She'd not been her usual self of late. Anderson would hold his hands up to say he was the least perceptive when it came to his colleagues, that he'd noticed it was definite cause for concern. All of the team had times when they kept their heads down, and it was understood to give space where needed. But he hadn't seen Bennett as guarded as she had been this week, not even with the nightmare she'd endured a year ago buying a new house. Come to think of it, that was the only pertinent piece of information he knew about Kate Bennett. Did she have a life beyond policing? He hoped she did, and that she was protecting it with her silence.
Come in. Forgive my rare good humour today. I can assure you it won't last.
The slightest glimmer of mischief flashed in her smile. That's a relief, Cuff. Although, I might be the one to end it.
Ah, well, I had my moment. Sit, please.
I just got word from Dave Wheeler. A body's been found in what looks like an illegal drug den.
Where?
Middle of nowhere. Abbott's farm on the Seymour Road near Watfield, about 12 miles out of Ipswich. It's been abandoned for 20 years, according to locals. But there have been several reports of loud music, lights and vehicles coming in and out for the last few months.
Were those investigated?
Bennett's expression said more than she needed to.
Wonderful. Are Soko's there?
On their way. It's been assigned the operational name Feldspar. D.S. Minshull should be back here shortly. He can tell you more.
Okay. Thanks for the heads up. Can you start preliminary inquiries into the location? Previous history, last occupants of the farm, any reports into suspicious activity and so on?
Bennett rose from her chair.
On it, Gov.
Excellent. Kate?
His young DC turned in the doorway.
Yes, Gov.
Is everything okay?
Bennett's steady smile tightened.
Yes, Gov.
I don't mean between you and I, although if I've offended you in any way.
You haven't, Gov.
Good, good. Well, if you have any concerns or issues you would like to talk over, I hope you know my door's always open.
Beneath his desk, Anderson's feet balled in his shoes. If his attempts to encourage Bennett to speak were this excruciating for him, how bad must it be for Kate?
I know, Gov.
She shuffled a little.
Is there anything else?
Briefly, her eyes dipped. Anderson caught it immediately.
That's all, he said, dropping his voice to a low burr. I value your work, Kate, but I also watch out for my team. It's important you know that. If you need anything...
Gov!
She nodded, gaze averted. Anderson sensed a door firmly closing.
Okay. Thank you.
Watching his DC hurry out into the open plan office, Anderson clocked DC Rob Minshull arriving.
Ah, Minshull, bring us a brew and step into my office, he barked happily.
Minshull's eye roll was another unexpected reward. He'd hate having to make coffee, and Anderson knew it. Might as well use his advantage while he was still in charge of the unit. 5 minutes later, surprisingly drinkable coffee delivered, and a flush-faced detective sergeant seated on the other side of his desk, Anderson faced Minshull.
So, we have a body.
Yes, Gov.
Any word on ID yet? It's too early to say. The body was still in situ when I left. It's been dumped in the middle of a large pile of old clothes and rubbish, most of it hidden.
We believe it's male. Beyond that, we won't know until the body can be retrieved.
What's your initial impression? Overdose? Rough sleeper?
Murder.
Anderson sat back in his seat, all traces of humour obliterated.
Because...
Minshull placed his mug slowly back on the desk, as if the action would order his thoughts.
It's been dumped. No way the deceased could have died where we found them, half buried by piles of clothing. Someone would have had to put the body there. They tried to cover it up, but failed. And I feel like the death was no accident either. It feels intentional, planned, although the method of the body's disposal was more an act of panic than planning.
In what way?
They made a pig's ear of concealing the body. One arm was hanging out of the clothing pile. The farmer from a neighbouring farm who alerted us said he'd found his dog licking it. Anderson shuddered.
So whoever dumped it there was in a hurry to get away. It doesn't prove murder. Perhaps they discovered the body and wanted to hide it. Like you say, they panicked. No evidence that the person who dumped the body also killed the deceased. No evidence that they didn't yet.
Minshull was clearly not ready to let go of his theory.
We'll know more when we get the body moved.
Fair enough. When's Dave due back?
He was just waiting to brief Socko's when they arrive, and then he was coming back here. Should be in the next hour or so.
Anderson nodded.
Right. Soon as he's back, we'll do a team briefing. You okay to sort it out?
Sure, Gov.
Anderson waved for his DS to leave, but just as Minshull reached the door, he called him back.
And Rob?
Thinly veiled consternation flashed across Minshull's expression.
Gov?
Grinning, Anderson lifted his mug.
Excellent coffee. Must have you make it more often.
Minshull's thin-lipped smile brightened Anderson's mood no end. Chapter 4. Bennett. Kate Bennett breathed a silent sigh of relief as she left Anderson's office. His question had come out of nowhere, and she'd barely managed to answer calmly. Had he noticed? Joel Anderson was a great boss most of the time, but he didn't always notice nuances like the change in emotions of his team. This new development was worrying. She busied herself at her desk while the banter of the CID office played out around her. Since the media broke the story about drug gangs from London and Essex crossing the border into Suffolk, she had been tasked with trying to establish which gangs were currently operational in the area. In many ways, South Suffolk police were flying blind. But Bennett relished the challenge. She loved a puzzle and the reward that came from untangling a seemingly impossible problem. It was why she'd been first choice when D.S. Minshull had assigned tasks for Operation Collegiate, the hastily commissioned investigation into the gangs plying their trade within the county. He appeared at her desk now, his face bearing a flush she only ever saw after his meetings with Anderson.
Kate, how's it going?
She stared at her screen. It's a needle in a haystack.
Yeah, sorry.
He bowed his head and pulled a chair up to sit beside her.
It's going to be a bastard to unravel.
She offered a smile. That's why you've got me.
I appreciate it. What do you have so far?
She turned back to her screen. I've been going over drug-related arrests over the last 9 months as a starting point, seeing if any names reappear.
Good.
Trouble is, all of these guys are small fry. They either no commented in interview or pleaded guilty in court because they knew a custodial sentence would be preferable to ratting out their bosses. We've had phones that auto-delete information or lock before we can decipher them, which suggest more organised groups, but so far that's all I've found in common.
Minshull sank back into his chair. It's all good stuff, Kate. We knew it wasn't going to be easy. Any links, however unimportant, could be key to bringing cases together. It's going to be a ton of work.
I don't mind, Bennett replied truthfully.
Right now, she welcomed the distraction. Okay, put this on hold for now and make the checks D.I. Anderson has asked for on Abbott's farm. Then as soon as you can, get back to it.
It was a lot of work, but work meant fewer awkward conversations to navigate. This morning, that was a gift.
An hour later, the history of Abbott's farm was slowly emerging in the notes on Bennett's notepad as she searched methodically for mentions of the farm. She'd been vaguely aware of DC Dave Wheeler arriving back in the CID office, but had quickly pushed the conversation of her colleagues to the back of her mind as she focused on her work. When she reached a natural break, she emerged into the middle of their conversation, a little dazed from her concentration.
"He's a bloody nightmare," DC Dave Wheeler was saying. "I always know when he's been here on nights, because I can never find anything."
"Oh, Bruce been stealing your post-its again, Dave,"
DC Les Evans smirked, enjoying the joke. Bennett saw DC Drew Ellis suppress a grin as he delivered mugs of tea to the team. Ordinarily, she would be in the thick of the CID office banter, but not today. She sent Ellis a brief smile as he placed her line-of-duty mug on her desk, a surprise bourbon biscuit carefully laid beside it. Bless him. He gave her a nod of solidarity before he moved away. Small gestures like that meant the world, even if right now Bennett couldn't fully process them. Nobody seemed unduly concerned about her, though, and that was a blessing in itself. The rest of the team carried on as usual around her, and Bennett was glad of the familiar ordinariness of it all.
"It's not about sticky notes, Les, it's about him, always choosing my desk to spread his gubbins over on night duty. Why doesn't he choose Drew's, Or Kate's, or yours?"
"He doesn't choose Les's desk because he'd have to excavate it first to find a flat surface," Ellis replied, causing Wheeler to choke on his tea.
Ellis had done more of that lately, returning fire on Evans's incessant mocking with whip-smart replies that floored his colleagues. Bennett remembered the lanky, beetroot-blushing youngster Ellis had been when he'd first joined as a probationary DC over a year ago. How much had changed since then? Inevitably, her mind strayed beyond the four walls of South Suffolk CID, dragging her heart to her heels. Too many things had changed.
"No!"
she scolded herself, forcing her attention back to the list of Abbott's farm mentions on her screen.
"I am not thinking of that today."
Around her, the team continued their jokes and moans about DC Bruce Ovenden, the detective who covered the CID office during the night. Bennett had only worked with him a handful of times, but she knew his reputation well. Everyone in the station did. By rights, he should have retired years ago. But as he was the only one happy to regularly cover the graveyard shift, he'd so far escaped every attempt by DCI Sue Taylor to coax him away.
"Leave him a note," Evans suggested, clearly enjoying himself. "Hands off my desk, Brucey. That ought to work."
Wheeler harrumphed into his tea. The sudden opening of Anderson's door sent every head dipping back to their screens as their superior appeared in the CID office.
"Okay, everyone. Briefing in 5 minutes, please."
"Gov."
"Yes, Gov."
Work was halted, notebooks grabbed and chairs shifted, the team quickly taking their seats around the large whiteboard on the wall beside Minshull's desk. Minshull had already pinned up initial photos of the abandoned farm where the body had been found, together with a map of the immediate area and the first image of the body in situ amid piles of clothing. When all were assembled, he turned to face them, snapping the lid back onto his whiteboard pen. Anderson perched on the spare desk alongside Bennett's and motioned for Minshull to begin.
"Thanks, everyone. So, we have a body discovered at 7 a.m. this morning, Wednesday the 19th of April, by Mr. William Carter, who owns a neighbouring farm. His dog found the body."
"A dog walker? Seriously?"
Evans chuckled, his mirth subsiding when Minshull shot him a look.
"Dave and I have already done that joke, Les,"
Minshull replied, with no hint of a smile, but a note of fun in his tone. "Keep up, yeah?" Evans slumped into disgruntled silence. Minshull turned back to the board. Bennett strongly suspected his move was to mask a smile. She thanked her stars again for the safe predictability of her colleagues. It helped, especially today.
"So, the body was located here, in the old barn at Abbott's farm, on the Seymour Road near Watfield. Kate, what do you have for us on that so far?"
Bennett consulted her notes. It's been disused as a farm since 1997, but I did find a record that Mr. Carter had previously contacted us regarding unusual activity on the site. Lights, noise, vehicles coming and going at strange times. There was a cash for clothes business that operated from that address about 2 years ago, but no mention of ownership or the site. I found a mention of it on a flyer posted on a community Facebook page. It seems it operated for about 6 months before it was abandoned.
That explains the discarded bags of clothes, Minshull observed. But you say whoever operated that wasn't listed as owner or tenant.
No, Sarge. My best guess is that someone set up there as a business squatter, abandoning it when they were discovered. I checked the land registry, but it appears the most recent owner died with no record of family to pass the farm on to.
Could a drug gang have operated it, or taken over the site when the clothes business left?
Les asked. Either are possible, Minshull began, silenced when Anderson held up a hand.
I don't think we can make that link at this stage, he said.
Bennett could tell from Minchell's expression that the DS may have already been working on that theory.
There are signs of drug activity there, Gov, Minshull replied. Recent, by the looks of it.
And that, added to Mr. Carter's reports, could suggest it could have been a viable location for drug operations. The report in the Sentinel was sensationalist, inconclusive speculation. Anderson snapped back.
The drug stuff could be local kids, rough sleepers. Bit far out for rough sleepers, Gov,
Wheeler interjected.
Our DOA could be a rough sleeper. The drug litter could be his.
With respect, Gov, our bloke didn't put himself there. Minshull tapped the blurred phone camera photo with his pen. Whoever he was, someone else shoved his body into that bank of clothes. Anderson reddened, but had to concede. Even from the blurry image, it was plain to see. The position of the body indicated someone had tried to conceal it within the layers of old clothing, badly, as it transpired.
So, are Op Collegiate and Op Feldspar linked?
Bennett asked, aware that her question could simultaneously win favour with one party and lose it with the other.
No, not yet,
Anderson answered before Minshull could reply.
We don't rule it out, but for the time being, we treat Operation Feldspar as wholly separate from Operation Collegiate. Op Feldspar has to be our priority until we have all the details of our victim, cause of death and history.
Minshull observed his superior for an uncomfortable moment. Not taking his eyes off Anderson, he replied,
Okay, stay on the Abbott's farm info search until we get a positive ID, but then I'll need you to go out with Drew for interviews.
Bennett knew it was inevitable, but that didn't make it any more palatable. Being out of the office, in a car with one of her colleagues, meant a greater possibility of fielding awkward questions. It was the last thing she needed. Turning from Anderson at last, Minshull addressed the team.
Dave, any update from the Sockos? They arrived about 10 minutes after you left. Got away from the Norfolk job earlier than expected.
But they were happy about that, Minshull smiled.
Happy to be back on the right side of the border,
Wheeler grinned.
Initial observations are being made now, and when the pathologist arrives and is happy, they'll move him.
Who's the duty pathologist today?
Anderson asked.
Dr. Amara,
Wheeler replied, frowning at a snigger from Evans.
Spooky Morticia.
Les,
I'm just saying, she's a scary woman.
So you're volunteering to attend the full post-mortem, are you? Minshull cut across his colleague. That was enough to silence Evans.
Thought not.
Dave, as soon as you have anything from the pathologist on site, let me know. Wheeler nodded.
Sarge.
Okay. Until we hear from the Sockos, we focus on missing persons reports for the last 6 months initially. Any males aged 18 to 40 reported missing in the county. Let's see if we can get a heads up on our victim as soon as possible.
Minshull surveyed the team. Bennett noticed that he didn't quite make eye contact with Anderson. It was unusual to see Minshull rattled by anything. When he looked back at her, Bennett busied herself with her notes.
Okay, thanks all. Be ready for when developments happen. As soon as they do, we'll move fast.
The team headed back to their desks, Bennett quick to get her head down as soon as she could to avoid being caught in one of the whispered conversations going on around her. A murder case was big news here,
and she could sense the itch of impatience amongst her colleagues. She understood it. Being given the news and then told to wait to get cracking on it was the worst. She left them to their hushed exchanges as she returned to her work. Lottie. They're sending a new person to see me. A doctor, apparently. They're coming today, Mum says. I could tell by the way she said it that she's getting her hopes up again. I hate that. It reminds me how powerless I am, how this thing can hurt everyone I love without a second thought. I've made the right decision to stay quiet, but I don't like hurting Mum. She's tried everything to help me, and with every new shot, I see hope dying in her a little more. I hear her crying in the bedroom when she thinks I'm not listening. She locks herself in there, pretending to dust, forgetting our house is one big glass echo chamber for her sobs. I'm not stupid. I know what she's doing. I hear everything. Dad's hurt too, probably, although it's impossible to see behind his short temper and ridiculous flounces out to the workshop. He's been barking about legal action lately, as if suing all the therapists, doctors and caseworkers who have tried to cure me is going to bring back my voice or make everything else go away. I don't like denying them what they want, but it's better than the alternative. If they knew the truth, it would end them. So I'll be a good girl when they arrive. And I'll smile and nod and type answers for the new one, but I won't budge. I can't. Dr. Cora Lyell can do what she wants, but she'll leave us, all the others have done, with nothing.
Chapter 5. Cora. Tris Noakes was waiting by his car when Cora arrived at the address of her latest case. He gave a self-conscious wave, stepping back as Cora parked.
Well, what do you think?
It's very different.
The approach to the house had been grand enough, its wide gravel drive sweeping up from the road, but the glass and steel building that greeted them at its end was something else. Its expansive glass exterior reflected the sky so that it was almost as if the building didn't exist, a barely perceptible ghost gazing across an uninterrupted view of the tidal estuary and out to the sea. Imagine living with that view every day, Tris said, his words almost stolen by the bracing blast of wind rushing over the lip of the manicured front garden towards them from the river valley below.
Gorgeous. But you'd never get anything done.
It was beautiful. But Cora tried to imagine how a 15-year-old might feel here, so far from other houses and seemingly on the edge of the world. It was a mile and a half outside the sprawling estuary village of Woodsham St. Mary and 6 miles from Lottie Arundel School. Did friends ever visit? Were the family involved in village life? Could isolation have contributed to Lottie's silence? The view is remarkable, she replied, turning back to the house.
Wait till you see inside. It's one of those upside-down houses, built specifically to take in the view. Bedrooms and bathrooms on the ground floor, living spaces on the first floor. Windows on all 4 sides up there, so you get a 360-degree view. It's the kind of place that would have George Clark in raptures.
Cora chuckled. You know, if you ever retire from the Ed Psych team, you've got a ready-made career as an estate agent. A guy can dream. His usual smile tightened a little. You all set?
As I'll ever be.
She had gone over Lottie's case file since Tris had handed it to her earlier that morning, noting any potential areas that previous professional investigations might have missed. But even though she went over every detail again, she found nothing. Lottie Arundel had no enemies of note, no professed fears relating to school, no previous history of anxiety or low self-esteem, nothing to explain why she didn't speak. Have you told Lottie's parents about my ability? Tris reddened.
Not yet. My plan is to see how we get on today, and provided you and Lottie get on well, we'll address your methods moving forward.
Cora wasn't sure whether it was an advantage to withhold the particulars of her condition or not. She'd wondered last night how they might approach the subject. She had formal training and qualifications identical to those held by Triss and the three other educational psychologists in the local authority-run unit, so there was weight to the argument that this was all Lottie's parents needed to know. But purposefully not sharing the advantage Cora's ability gave her over the rest of the team sat uneasily with her. If Lottie and I are going to work together, it's important her parents know.
Of course. Leave that to me. So, any theories yet?
I can't see a general cause, and until I've spoken with her and the family, it's too early to say.
But, come on, Cora, I know you. You never go into any case without a working theory.
She had to concede that point. It was both a source of significant comfort and undeniable irritation that Triss Noakes understood her so well after such a short time working together. She glanced up at the drifting clouds reflected in the upper story of the house. I think we're looking to identify an event rather than an issue. In every other respect, on paper at least, Lottie is a standard 15-year-old with a pretty regular kind of life. Something must have happened to make her fall silent. One event, or perhaps a few that are linked.
Such as?
She gave a shrug, willing the sense of unease to leave her. Whatever had caused Lottie Arundel to choose silence over words must have been significant. Cora had been only a year older when her ability had first manifested, the memory of it still raw despite the years that had passed. Nobody should have to face trauma like that, let alone a 15-year-old. I don't know.
Interesting.
Triss nodded, but his half-smile revealed satisfaction that he'd made the right choice to bring Cora here. Let's get started, shall we? The woman who greeted them at the door didn't smile, despite her words of welcome. She was dressed in the kind of easy, casual wear that cost a small fortune. Cream cashmere sweater, soft grey leggings, and a large shawl scarf the colour of the first pink of dawn. But it was her eyes that Cora was immediately drawn to. Haunted, far-gazing, without focus. She had seen eyes like that before, in a young mother terrified for the safety of her eldest child. The difference here was that Monica Arundel was facing the disappearance of her daughter while the child remained in full sight. A sudden rush of heavy sighs rose up to meet Cora as she and Triss followed Lottie's mother up the glass staircase to the first floor. The jarring sound came from everywhere, despite the space being completely free of clutter. It was as if the deepest emotions of those who lived in the glass house on the hill had seeped into the very fabric of the building, disturbed by her arrival. Cora shuddered. Beside her, she felt the weight of Triss's stare.
"Thank you for coming,"
Monica Arundel said, pausing by an opaque blue glass floating wall at the head of the staircase.
"Lottie is waiting for you. Please try to help her."
The dashed hopes of 11 months hung on her words.
"I'll do all I can,"
Cora replied, the briefest glimpse of life flickering in the woman's stare in reply. Triss had been right about the breathtaking interior. The entire top floor was glass, light flooding in from all sides. The expanse of cream-carpeted space incorporated a pale grey kitchen, a dining area with a glass table and transparent acrylic ghost chairs, and a wide seating area filled with a collection of white linen interlinked sofas. Seated at the farthest edge of them was the girl Cora recognized from the photographs in her case file. Dressed in black, with long dark hair, Lottie Arundel was a stark shadow in the space filled with light. She looked impossibly small, dwarfed by the furniture and windows around her, so that it appeared she was caught amid clouds. She was watching them from behind a veil of fringe, head high, despite the uniform of a disgruntled teen. The walk across the open floor seemed to take an eternity. Cora, aware of whispers of Lottie's parents from every flat surface and the stark absence of the girl's voice. Cora had spent her adult life sensing emotional echoes from objects, her ability now diagnosed as emotional synesthesia. But the voices were always attached to specific things,
Waste paper and empty takeaway detritus, old newspapers left on cafe tables, belongings that had recently been used or worn or held. It was as if the act of a person touching an object left not just physical fingerprints, but also emotional ones. Recently, Cora had trained her mind to search for the sounds around objects, giving her a multidimensional soundscape from which she could sense the setting of the last place an object had been held, external sounds to suggest the location, and sensations of temperature, air, and emotion. She was aware that the more she utilized her ability, the more she discovered. But the sense of sound surrounding the Arundel house was new and unsettling. Cora could guess at the direction from which the voices came. But in the ultra-neat, supremely controlled environment, it was impossible to tell exactly. Nothing was out of place here. No discarded newspapers, empty mugs, or half-read books set aside on the arms of the couches. As she neared Lottie Arundel, a new sound emerged. But it wasn't the girl's voice, as she had expected. It was an intake of breath, repeating endlessly, the volume increasing the closer Cora moved to the teenager. A myriad of inhales, with no exhale following. Cora felt it, tight at the center of her own chest, as real as if she were holding her own breath. Cora? Triss touched her arm, and Cora became aware of three pairs of eyes observing her.
Yes?
I was just telling Lottie that you're our consultant psychologist. Mentally muting the sounds of the breaths, Cora forced a smile.
I am. Hi, Lottie. I'm Dr. Cora Lyle. Good to meet you.
Lottie observed her for a moment, then looked down at an iPad resting in her lap. Her nails squeaked a little as they tapped the screen. A synthesized voice cut sharply into the room as the girl raised her eyes back to stare at Cora.
Thank you for coming to see me.
You're welcome. Mind if we sit with you?
Lottie blinked, fingers moving across the glass.
Be my guest.
We were recommended the app Lottie is using by the last neurologist we saw,
Monica said, her flat tone indicating the many experts who had been where Cora was now.
It's been a godsend. Lottie's found it so helpful. Haven't you, love?
Yes.
The generated voice sounded sarcastic, the delivery jarring. Cora felt Triss fidgeting self-consciously beside her. Monica glanced between them, her carefully manicured fingers twisting and untwisting the fabric of her scarf.
She has a tablet at school, but was using a notebook at home, or sometimes WhatsApp for messages to us. But the delay, it made everything take much longer than speaking normal.
The sudden closure of her mouth severed the end of her sentence. Lottie's gaze slid to her mother. Without looking away, she typed another message.
It feels more natural this way, like I'm just talking normally. You like it better, don't you, Mum?
Cora caught the instinctive clench of Monica's jaw, felt the air constrict around Lottie's mother for an instant.
That's right, she rushed,
her tone as flat as the computer voice. Her daughter sent a shy smile to her mother before looking back at Triss.
So what do you want to do this time?
I thought we could chat with Dr. Lyle. See if you get on.
Here?
Triss looked at Lottie's mother. Anywhere you feel comfortable. A walk outside, maybe? It's a lovely morning.
It's better we stay here for the first meeting, Monica replied, her expression flint. I want to hear what Dr. Lyle has to say.
I'd like a walk, Mum.
Maybe next time, if you get on.
The bristle at her daughter's words was impossible to conceal. Lottie betrayed no outward signs of frustration, but the unspoken breaths grew louder around her. Cora decided to step in.
I'll level with you both before we begin. I don't know if I can help, but I can listen and maybe come up with some strategies.
No offense, but that's what every other person Dr. Noakes brings here says.
Lottie!
No, Mum, you know it's true. I don't want to upset you and I don't want to let anyone down. But endless questions and breathing exercises and fake friendly chats aren't going to bring my voice back.
The slap of the synthesized words was absolute. Watching her colleague sag and Lottie's mother tense, Cora felt her heart drop. Why did she think she could do this? Triss meant well, but bringing her into this case had been a mistake. Lottie clearly didn't want to speak. If eminently qualified speech therapists and consultant neurologists had failed to find a solution, what hope did Cora have? Tea, Triss rushed, a hint of hysteria in his cheeriness. We should make some tea, Monica, don't you think?
I'm not sure tea will help.
Monica, in all the time I've been coming here, you've kept promising to show me your wonderful kitchen, but I've yet to have the tour. I would love to see what you've done with it. He really was grasping at straws now. Lottie's gaze drifted back to the window. Torn between supporting her daughter and the chance to talk about something other than the issue dominating their lives, Monica hesitated.
But Lottie, I'll sit with her,
Cora replied quickly, the grateful smile she received from Triss, proof that this was what he'd hoped she'd say. The view is very special from here. Monica Arundel's frown softened a little.
It is, isn't it? Best view in Suffolk, I think.
She rearranged the dawn pink scarf around her neck.
So, tea and a tour, Dr. Noakes?
The held breaths around the teenager remained, but the volume began to reduce as her mother and Triss walked away to the far side of the upper floor. Cora said nothing, taking time to breathe and think. It was how she dealt with every instance of heard voices, affording herself space to calmly work out her response. This was unlike anything she had experienced before, and the challenge was immediately outfacing. In order to find a way to deal with it, she needed to identify the elements that this occurrence shared with previous heard voices. I'm sensing sound that audibly represents emotion. I can mute each sound in turn as it arrives. It may be a breathing sound instead of audible words or phrases, but they come from the same place. As she noted each aspect of the new sound, the hushed breath intakes coming from the young girl slowly fell under Cora's control. Opposite, Lottie shifted self-consciously. In a standard interaction, this would be where Cora's client would give in to the impulse to talk, to fill the awkward gap, often sharing more information than they had originally intended. It was a method she had discussed with Rob Minshull during one of their walks along the Suffolk coast, Rob admitting he used it to great effect during police interviews. Here, in the glass house, in the absence of words, it had a disquieting effect for both Cora and Lottie. She allowed the silence to stretch further before she spoke, keeping her voice low. I don't want to make you talk, she said, careful to keep her eyes on the wide expanse of Suffolk countryside beyond the glass. I'm not here to judge your reasons for staying silent or trick you into speaking. I just think maybe nobody has listened to you yet. Really listened to you. Lottie didn't turn her head, but in the periphery of her vision, Cora saw her fingers return to the screen.
Nobody listens.
So try me. A glance, then, fast and quickly over, the fringe veil parted for just a moment.
Why does it matter to you?
Why did it? In many ways, it would be easier to admit she was the wrong fit for this case and walk away. But the repeated inhales and visceral sense of constriction surrounding Lottie made Cora think of all the years she had felt locked in by her own mind. Being on the periphery was something Cora knew only too well. Because I think it should matter. I think you deserve to be heard. When she turned to face the girl, Lottie was staring at her. That kitchen is something else. Triss was back, his forced cheeriness breaking the moment. Cora glanced at Lottie, but she had turned back to the window. We made tea. Cora? Despairing of her colleague, Cora accepted the cup and saucer he held out to her. Monica Arundel resumed her seat beside her daughter, and Triss whittled on for a while, filling the space with unwanted words. When he paused long enough to draw breath, he finally caught Cora's eye and didn't speak again.
Were you all right while we were gone?
Monica asked the air between her daughter and Cora, not quite looking at either of them.
We were just looking at the view, Cora said,
as Lottie's fingers began to traverse the tablet screen.
I want Cora to come back.
Do you?
Monica's voice cracked, her teacup gripped in her hands.
By herself next time, please.
Triss flushed beside Cora. Yes, of course. That's perfectly fine.
Thank you.
Lottie sent Cora a brief nod before turning back to the window. Cora sensed the constriction lessen for just a moment, heard the breaths skip a beat. It would have been so easy to miss. But it was there. A tiny crack in the wall. An invitation.
Chapter 6. Wheeler. The waiting was the worst. Around him, the detectives of South Suffolk CID busied themselves as best they could, but restlessness prowled between the desks like a stalking lion. He kept vigil at his desk, one eye trained on his phone. Brian Hines, the chief scene of crime officer, had promised to call him as soon as they had moved the body. The pathologist had been held up on her journey there, and everything was now on hold until her arrival. Meanwhile, twiddling his thumbs on the other end of the line while he waited for news felt like a special kind of purgatory.
Genesis, they're linked,
Evans whispered, leaning towards Wheeler's desk. Wheeler replied with an eye roll.
I'm just saying. Drug stuff found near the body, in an abandoned barn with previous reports of suspicious activity, and we know it would be a gift to drug gangs wanting out-of-the-way locations.
Give it a rest, eh?
Evans gave a loud tut and slunk back to his work. Wheeler bristled. He understood the jokes. Everyone in CID cracked them to compensate for the frustrations of the job. But he'd been to the crime scene today, had seen the senseless end of a life, and was still trying to shake the smell of death from his clothes. This one felt personal. He'd seen the tattoo on the bluing skin and been within touching distance of the deceased. You didn't forget near contact like that. You certainly didn't try to make a fast buck out of it.
Dave, any news?
Minshull paused by Wheeler's desk on the way to the small office kitchen area, empty mug in hand.
Not yet.
Minshull nodded and carried on walking. The first hours of the investigation were critical, everyone knew, making any delay seem gratuitous. The proper processes had to be observed, of course, everything done in the correct manner to gather as much evidence while the body was in situ, to help bring those responsible to justice, and some comfort to the loved ones of the victim. But until the ball started rolling, everything seemed to take an age. The farmer had alerted the police at 7 a.m. Wheeler and Minshull attending by 8, Socko's arrived at 10 a.m. just as Dave was getting restless, waiting, and he'd passed Dr. Amara's car on her way to the scene as he was driving back to the CID office in Ipswich around 10:30 a.m. Now it was approaching noon, and already the day seemed the longest he'd endured for some time. He almost jumped out of his skin when the desk phone rang, every head at the desks around him lifting as one, every ear attuned to the conversation.
DC, Wheeler, he answered.
Dave, it's Brian Hines over at the crime scene. We've just moved the body with Dr. Amara leading. So, we have a white male, approximately 25 to 35 years old. He has the tattoo you mentioned, a brown velvet top hat. He also has a bloody big hole in the back of his head.
What? Hole of the back of his head, bashed in, poor beggar.
He's been slammed with tremendous force. He wouldn't have stood a chance against that.
It was a shock to hear. There had been no visible sign of any such injury when Wheeler and Minshull had attended the scene, but the victim's head had been obscured beneath the layers of old clothing and rubbish bags.
No prizes for guessing cause of death, then?
Wheeler said, grimacing at his colleagues who were heading over to his desk.
Any idea how long he's been there?
Hard to say, although judging by the state of the body, I reckon a few weeks at least. Dr. Amara's pretty sure the fatal blow wasn't administered in the barn. We've only found traces of blood in the vicinity of the body so far, and nowhere near the amount we'd expect to see on the stack of clothing that was covering him. Reckon he was attacked and brought here to be dumped.
That's what D.S. Minshull and I wondered when we saw him. Can you get us some updated photos ASAP, Bri?
Just send them over, Dave.
Cheers, mate.
Ending the call, Wheeler addressed his colleagues.
Right. We've got a white male, 25 to 35, suspected fatal head injury, but it looks like he might have been attacked somewhere else and dumped there. Might have been there for a while, Brian reckons, although that's just his guess on sight.
Minshull made notes as Wheeler spoke.
Okay, so we treat this as a murder investigation, separate from Op Collegiate for the time being, but I want to know what the link is between our body and the drug litter found nearby. Kate, Les, step up those MISPAS searches, please. Dave, do we have the latest photos?
Downloading them now.
Good work. Drew, do a sweep of social media, see if there have been any references to local men gone missing who fit our body's description. Also, check for speculation or mentions regarding the farm. People say stuff online that they don't report. You might find something we've missed.
No problem, Sarge.
Wheeler found the email just arrived from Brian Hines and printed out the photos attached to it. The images slowly appeared at the mouth of his printer, his stomach churning as the full extent of the victim's head injury glared into sight. He had to look away until the whirring of the machine fell silent. Scooping up the sheets and taking them straight to Minshull's desk. Minshull didn't flinch when he accepted them, pinning them straight to the board and standing back to quietly observe the lurid display.
Not drugs, then?
Wheeler ventured, keen to put conversation between himself and the crime scene images.
Drugs didn't kill him, no. But I wonder.
His voice trailed away as he scanned the images.
If he was involved? As what? Drug runner? Someone higher up? I doubt someone higher up would be dumped like our guy. Although it's a heck of a message to send to the rest of the gang if one of the commanders stepped out of line. Maybe.
Minshull let out a long sigh.
I mean, it could be a coincidence. The guy could be a rough sleeper in the wrong place at the wrong time, like Anderson thinks. But that's not your gut. I think there might be a link, that's all.
He peered closer at the side view of the body, tapping the visible top hat tattoo with his pen.
That's our best hope for the time being. I can't imagine too many MISPAs in our files have a tattoo like that.
He looked over to the rest of the team.
Les, can you search specifically for a mention of a top hat tattoo in the MISPAs files? I can narrow it down to tattoos, but after that it's a case of going through every one on the list. Well, that's better than nothing. How about checking to see if the design is a symbol of any groups or organisations too? It might lead us closer to finding out his identity. Kate, are you okay to help? We need an ID as soon as we can. Everything hangs on that.
Sarge!
Wheeler watched Bennett hurry to Evans's desk.
You think someone reported him missing?
Minshull's eyes were wide as he looked back at the board.
I bloody hope so.
Chapter 7. Minshull. Anderson's good mood from earlier had now vanished completely. The arrival of the updated crime scene photographs had temporarily lifted his spirits, but now, 3 hours later, he had regressed to a brooding, muttering Caledonian bore.
No word on ID. No word from the path lab. What the hell is taking everyone so long?
Seated on the other side of Anderson's desk, Minshull kept his voice calm and steady to counteract his superior's mood.
The team are moving as fast as they can. I've put Drew on it as well as Les and Kate. If our man is in there, they'll find him. I know that. I do. It's just frustrating.
Minshull held up his hands.
I am with you on that, Gov. But we have everything in place to find out who he is. And Dr. Amara is the best. If she's taking her time, it's a good thing.
Anderson gave a long groan, stretching the stubborn knots from his shoulders.
You're right. Forgive me. Any news on Op Collegiate? Nothing yet. Kate's done some sterling work already. As soon as we have an ID for our body, she'll go back to the search. You still think they're linked?
It was a leading question, Minshull knew. But the chance to distract Anderson for a while was too tempting.
We're treating the two investigations as separate concerns, as you suggested.
That's not what I asked.
Minshull observed his superior. If the drug litter found in the barn is a coincidence, it's a pretty interesting one. Right now, that's all I have.
Bollocks, Rob. I know how your mind works. What are your theories?
So much for towing the party line. He could be a user who owed too much, but why go to all the trouble of stashing the body where it was for someone at the bottom of the food chain? If he were higher up in command, perhaps he overstepped the mark and was taken out as a warning.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.